Kentucky Senator Rand Paul here to talk about a couple of things. How are you, Senator? And welcome back to America. I see you shaking your head there. Monica Lewinsky shot out this tweet yesterday. Grateful to the myriad people who have helped me evolve, gain perspective in the last 20 years. And I think she had a link to a Vanity Fair article that came out a few months prior on her. He sounded contrite last night. How did he sound to you? The way we view the 1990s through the lens of this Me Too movement today.
It sounded like Bill Clinton took a poll from one interview to the next. They poll tested a response and he decided, you know what, I better apologize more because they'll come after me next. But Bill Clinton epitomizes, you know, sort of the aggressor, not the victim. He thinks he's still somehow a victim. And in no world was it ever appropriate for the President of the United States to be having sex under his desk with a 20-year-old. There's no way is that can that even be consented to. So if he doesn't understand that, and see the mainstream media for decades were complicit with Bill Clinton. Oh, well, it was consensual. Well, to tell you the truth, you can't really have an appropriate consensual relationship with a 20-year-old intern in your office. That is the definition of sexual harassment. It's a definition of using the power of your office to get something you want.
All clear on that. But you know, he apologized in 1998 at the National Prayer Breakfast. So, I mean, what you're saying is that the apologies today are not enough?
Well, it sounded like in the first interview, he was still playing the victim. Oh, woe is me, and I just barely did anything wrong, and I was so bankrupt. Well, since then, he's made hundreds of millions of dollars selling the prestige of the presidency to anybody who'll buy it, including Russians. I mean, my goodness, he sold himself all over the planet. He will talk to any group, particularly if somehow he can feather his nest.
Let's move to North Korea, shall we? Brian Bender, Politico, has a piece today. Interesting first paragraph. Here it is on screen. He writes, expect lies, do your homework, because they will have. Choose your words very carefully and have Job-like patience. Oh, and remember that North Korean leader Kim Jong-un considers himself a supreme being. You got a prediction for Tuesday, Senator?
You know, I wouldn't overestimate or have too high of an expectations, but I've been very hopeful that it's the beginning of dialogue. I think the dialogue is good, and I think it's one of President Trump's strong points that he's willing to do this. Most other presidents would have studied this to death, litigated it to death, had so many preconditions that it never would have happened. And this is one reason why it hasn't happened. So, no, I think there's a big step forward. South Korea's been showing an openness to dialogue. Now the president is showing openness to dialogue. It's not a guarantee that we'll get something good. And, of course, when you do have dialogue and you do have diplomatic exchanges, it's a trust but verify situation.
Yeah,
so it may not be immediate peace, but I think the beginning of dialogue is a great thing.
I think my sense is that he's kind of where you are on this. Here was the tweet from an hour ago. Meeting in Singapore and North Korea will hopefully be the start of something big. We will soon see. He's leaving the door wide open that maybe it works and maybe it doesn't.
Yeah, and I think that the alternative is, you know, talking about, you know, preemptive war and all this other craziness. So I think dialogue, diplomacy is good, no guarantees. And we do have to be aware they have negotiated in the past in a duplicitous fashion. We gave them money over a period of a decade and they developed a nuclear weapon anyway. And I think one important thing the president has said is we're not giving them U.S. taxpayer money. If there's any kind of agreement, it will be an opening to trade with South Korea and an opening to trade with Japan, which will have incredible rewards. But the U.S. taxpayer should not be paying them to not develop nuclear weapons. And I think the proof will be in the conclusion. We'll see what comes.
And what is interesting with the president's mouth several times is he said that, you know, this is a leader who wants to modernize his own country. And they got a long way to go to do that. You just mentioned war. Tomorrow you've got this hearing on the AUMF, the authorized use of military force. It appears that the president's kind of on your side when it comes to part of this argument. Do you agree? Do you see it that way?
I think we've been at war too long in too many places. And when I talk to the president about the Afghan war, I think there's a big part of the president says we have been there too long and we've squandered too much money. His tweets throughout the past several years have said, you know what, we need to look at America first. We're spending $50 billion a year in Afghanistan. So, yeah, I do think the president is with me on this. On the Constitution, our founding fathers are with me, too. Congress is supposed to declare war. President should not be given the unlimited authority to be at war anywhere on the planet. And so what we're going to debate in our hearing tomorrow is whether or not Congress should declare war or the president and whether or not we can give up that power.
You've got to drag a lot of senators around to your point of view there. Quickly, I got to run.
All right, you're exactly right. We'll see how it goes, but we're going to have a great panel. Judge Napolitano will be there, Jonathan Turley, and also someone from the ACLU. So we're going to have a really good, high-powered panel to discuss the constitutionality of this.
We've heard those guys before. Thank you, Senator, for your time today. Rand Paul on the Hill.
Thank you.